Hello everyone, Michael here. This is part 4 of my OpenLAP series. In part 3, we talked about the vehicle model. Today, we're going to talk about the track model and go through the track file creation. Feel free to download the code, follow along, and pause and rewatch parts whenever you need to. Also, because I have updated the code, you should re-download OpenTRACK even if you already have it. Let's first go through the workflow. What you need to do is select your Excel or CSV file with your tracks data and run OpenTRACK. What gets created from this is a track model in a .mat file. This .mat file is then used in OpenLAP. The Excel or the CSV file itself are not used. In OpenTRACK, you can create tracks in two ways. You can declare simple segments in an Excel file and use them as building blocks that get connected together to form a track. Moreover, you can export log data in a CSV format from which the track shape gets calculated. The third way of generating a track from an image is not yet included. Now, both of these methods use a specific template for the Excel file and the CSV file. So let's now open Excel and look at some example files and the templates. We will first look at the shape generation example for SPA. In the info sheet, you declare the name and the rest of the basic info in cells B1 to B7. In the shape sheet, you add your section in each row by typing in the type, the section length, and the corner radius. Whenever you need to add more segments, you just fill the table downwards. In the elevation and banking sheets, you input the position in the A column and the value for the elevation and banking in the B column. The same applies for the grip factors. In the sector sheet, you type in the starting point of each sector and the sector number. Obviously, the first sector starts at 0 meters. We will now look at the log data generation example for Paul Ricard. Again, in the cells B2 to B8, you input your basic track info. Underneath that, in cell B9, you type in the value for the frequency in hertz that you used when exporting the data. This frequency is used when filtering the data. Then, in cells A14 to H whatever, you put your data. The channels have to be in the order that the template file specifies, otherwise you will get bad results as the code assumes that everything is where it should be. Now, if you don't have yaw velocity, you can just put 0 everywhere. The same applies to elevation and banking. Also, put 1 everywhere for the grip factor when you start modeling the track. Then the sector number at each position should be an input here. You can have as much data as you want, but the frequency of 50 Hz is more than enough in my opinion. Also, it does not matter if you have duplicate lines at the same distance or position. The code takes only unique lines in terms of distance into account. In terms of units, I have already coded some conversions in the code, but if you wish to be able to use others as well, you will need to make modifications. We will see in a bit where this conversion happens. On GitHub, you will find empty template files for a new track creation both for the shape and the log data modes. You will have one Excel or CSV file for each track that you create. Let's now talk about the basic info and the settings. These here are the things you can change. I have included some settings like the country, the city, and the type that are just there as extra pieces of information you might want to use to differentiate or catalog your tracks. But the ones that have an effect and drive the model in the .mat file are the configuration, the direction, and the mirror option. Also note that the .mat model file name is defined by the name of the track in the Excel or CSV file and not the name of the Excel or CSV file itself. The values you can use are inside the quotes. We will go through what these settings do, just keep in mind that you need to spell this out correctly. Now let's move on to the track generation itself. We will talk about the generation from shape data first. Think of the track as being a puzzle that you can create by fitting a bunch of different pieces together. First, you specify the type of the segment or section. You can use straights, right turns, and left turns. Then you define the length of each segment. Obviously, the sum of all the lengths of all the segments will be the final track length. Also, whenever you define a turn, the length input should be the length of the circular segment. Then you define the radius of each segment, keeping in mind that the radius is assumed to have that exact value in the center of the turn and gets interpolated and smooth. We will see how that happens in a bit. Also, you have to set the radius to 0 whenever you define a straight. Moreover, in the table, you can just add points by filling in the blank cells and extending the table in Excel. The code as is reads up to 10,000 points, but this can be changed in the data reading functions if needed. In terms of elevation, banking, and localized grip factors, you define a point and what its corresponding value is. For the sectors, you add a sector by defining its starting point and its number. Obviously, sector number 1 starts at 0 meters. Whenever you define a point that is out of bounds, then it gets ignored. Also, the topology is then interpolated for the in-between points and extrapolated if the first or last point is not exactly 0 or less than the exact total length respectively. Again, adding stuff is easy. You just add values downwards up to 10,000. If you need more, you can change the max value in the data loading functions. To simulate a smooth transition between different segments with different corner radiuses and not get weird and unrealistic results, the inputs have to be processed. If you think about the shape input you provide OpenTRACK with, it looks something like this on the right, with a turning radius being constant in each segment. So what OpenTRACK does is leave straights untouched and take into account the center point of each turn segment. This means that it deals with the blue points shown on the right. Then it creates a smooth curve that passes through those points. This obviously does create some errors and does not represent the input exactly, but in my opinion is better than the constant radius assumption and more realistic. I tried using the red curve directly during development, but it created weird looking results. Obviously, the smaller the defined segment length, the smoother and more accurate the result. But what about long constant radius corners? Let's look at the example on the right, and let's show the same points as before. Now, if we pass a curve from these three points, you can see that it creates a much bigger error as the area underneath the yellow curve is half the area under the red curve. Now, to deal with these situations, we inject points. Then we use these points to fit a new curve that resembles the red one more. The distance of this injected point from each end is calculated via this formula. You can see two things. First is that the maximum value this length can have is 1/3 of the segment length. Secondly, you see the kappa parameter that is used as a setting in OpenTRACK to adjust the final shape. This kappa parameter basically defines the maximum segment angle allowed. We will see what the segment or section angle is in a bit when we talk about the map creation. Let's now talk about the other end of the spectrum, logged data. To create a map from log data, we need speed and lateral acceleration as a bare minimum to define the shape. These channels are then used to calculate the turning radius via the pure circular motion equation at each point. You will see that you get both negative and positive values for the turning radius. This just defines the cornering direction. If you go back to part 3, where we talked about the axis convention in the vehicle model, you will see that positive y is left. So to keep the same convention here and make things easier, positive R means a left turn and negative R means a right turn. Finally, the curvature is defined as the inverse turning radius. The reason we use turning curvature in the end instead of the radius itself is because on a straight, the radius is infinite. So the graph shoots up to huge values and you need to clip it at a specific value. If you use curvature on the other hand, then on a straight you get zero. Also, sometimes the infinity makes weird things pop up in the code. Now, as I said previously, there are more channels you can use. First of all, you can use Yore to calculate the curvature. In my experience, it gives a better result in the final shape. Also, although I have not tried it, you can use a gyro or accelerometers to obtain the banking of the circuit at each point from a very slow lap on the racing line. Finally, you can use an altitude sensor, GPS data, or even Google Earth to get the altitude. When using yaw velocity, the equation that gives us the turning radius and curvature is now linear velocity over yaw velocity. For smoothing noisy data that come from the logger, I have included the moving average filter. This takes into account the filter DT variable, which represents the time period that you want to take into account when you filter your data. And to convert this time variable to a unitless number so that we can use it inside the filter, we multiply it by the logging frequency and then round the result. In the plot on the right, you can see data recorded at 50 Hz filtered with this method for a period of half a second. Let's now talk about the track map calculation and generation. Let's assume that the vehicle is negotiating a left turn, is at a random point PS, and is traveling towards a random direction. The turning circle center will be at some distance normal to the trajectory to the left. If the vehicle travels forward, the next point PN will be somewhere on this circle, where the length of the circular segment is equal to the distance traveled. Geometry tells us that the heading angle HS that the car has when at the starting point has the same value as the angle between the line that connects the turning circle center with the point PS and the y-axis. Moreover, the angle that is formed between the two heading directions at the points PS and PN has the same value as the circular segment angle theta S. The heading angle at point PN is the summation of the heading angle at point PS and the circular segment angle. This means that the heading angle at a specified point is equal to the cumulative sum of all the circular segment angles for all the previous points. Then we subtract the value of the first circular segment to set the heading angle at the first point to zero, meaning that it points to the positive side of the x-axis. Now you could go through and calculate the next point using the circle. Although this works perfectly for shape data, I have had bad luck with log data. So what I do is choose one of two ways. The first one is that you calculate the next point assuming the vehicle will travel in a straight line in the direction shown by the heading angle of the next point for a distance equal to the circular segment length. This is then point PN of HN. Or you can calculate the next point using the heading angle at the same point PS. This gives you the point PN of HS. I have tried both and gotten the same results basically, so I just chose to calculate PN of HS when I calculate the map. The equation that gives you the coordinate of this next point is shown on the top right. It takes the coordinate of the point PS and adds a vector that has the circular segment length value in its x component and is rotated by the heading angle at point PS. One thing to keep in mind is that the heading angle is 0 at the start of the lap, plus 360 degrees at the end of a counterclockwise closed circuit, minus 360 degrees at the end of a clockwise closed circuit, 0 at the end of a closed figure 8 circuit like Suzuka. Okay, so we are now able to create a map. But what if the shape is not right? That can happen for two reasons. First, if your data has kind of a weird scaling in it, then the shape might be distorted. Think of it as a very sensitive accelerometer that thinks that you are doing a U-turn whenever you just wiggle it a bit. Secondly, you might have problems if the accelerometer is not zeroed correctly. Or, let's better say, if there's any kind of bias in it. This can make the code think, for example, that you are always turning left, although you are going straight, or even turning right. Because zeroing has not a global and easy fix, I have left it up to you. So zero your accelerometers correctly. But for the scaling, I have included a parameter lambda that scales the value of the circular segment angle. The effect of this parameter can be seen in these four maps of polar card. As you can see, the more you increase lambda, the more squiggly the map gets, and the more you decrease it, the more circular the map gets. This is because this is a closed map, so there is another correction on top of this that closes the loop. If this was an open track and you decreased lambda to zero, you would just get straight. Now we can talk about the two configurations. We can have both closed and open tracks in OpenTRACK. When a map is closed, three things happen. Firstly, the first and the last point get connected. Secondly, the map is made tangent at the start and finish lines. And thirdly, things like elevation and banking are linearly modified to have the same value at the first and last points. When a track is open, there are no modifications made to it. But there is a problem during the lap simulation in OpenLAP, and this is that we need to specify a boundary condition at the start that defines the speed, as this is not the case of a flying lap. For this reason, OpenLAP enforces a standing start, meaning that it sets a speed of 0 at the start. You can obviously modify this value if you want. Now, some of you may say, okay, so we can define a closed track, but how does OpenTRACK actually close it? Well, this is done in two stages. First comes the tangency correction. As you can see, the method we use to calculate the map shape of polar card from log data has given us a result that is open. The tangent line at the start looks something like this, and the direction the vehicle has at the finish line is this. The angle between them is what we have to fix. Now at this stage, I have included kind of an automatic figure 8 detection. To do this, we need a way to remove the whole number of turns from the equation. This is done by selecting the minimum absolute value between the remainder of the division of the heading angle error plus or minus 360 degrees depending on the sign of the heading angle error, and the second value, which is the value of the heading angle at the end minus its sign times 360. And the reason I use the sign of the heading angle here is to automatically take into account counterclockwise and clockwise circuits. Then, with the value of the error known, we linearly modify the heading angle. If you look at the equation, you can see that there is no modification for the first point because x is equal to 0, and the last point receives all the modification to become tangent as x equals L and x divided by L is equal to 1. Then we can recalculate the circular segment angles. With these new angles now known, we can recalculate the map and stage 1 is complete. Stage 2 is where we actually close the track. First, we calculate the position error, dp. Then, we linearly adjust the position for all the points just like before. This gives us the final result with the correct map for polar card. To help you visualize what happens, let's watch this animation. In stage 1, the tangency is fixed. You can see that the starting points are barely moved, but as the algorithm goes on, they are adjusted more and more. Also, the track is distorted in a way that fixes a tangency error, but does not close the loop. Finally, you can see the red vectors representing the movement of the map points. Due to the rotation, the upper left points on the screen are moved a lot. It looks like we have a rotation about the starting point. In dark gray, we have the map before the tangency fix, and in blue, the map after the tangency fix. Then we go to stage 2. This is where we close the map. And sure enough, when the algorithm is done, we get the desired result. As you can see, light gray is what we started with, dark gray is after stage 1, and blue is the final result. You can also see the position adjustment vectors in red. Note that they are all parallel to each other compared to before, and the vector's length is proportional to the travel distance in the lap. Now in this graph, you can see the differences between these two methods. Note that in the upper plot, we have a rotational distortion, and in the lower plot, we have a translational distortion. Now, the rest of the settings are pretty self-explanatory. The mirror option basically mirrors the lateral acceleration or yaw channel to create the opposite hand version of the track. The direction option lets you run the track backwards. And the rotation option just rotates the map using the same rotation matrix about the z-axis. This is just a visual thing for the plot. A positive value for the angle rotates the map counterclockwise. Having gone through all this, let's now look at the code. First, we clear the memory. Then we define the file name, and then we set the mode we want to run. For log data, we specify the use of the lateral acceleration or the yaw channel for the calculation of the curvature. After, in the settings, we set the mesh size, the filtering duration, the visual map rotation, the shape factor lambda, and the long corner angle adjustor kappa. Then we read the specified file. First, we check if we are in the log data mode. Then we extract the tracks information, the channels, the units, the frequency. We define the columns and extract the data from the data matrix to separate variables. Then we go through and convert all the units. Here is where you will find how to spell every unit as well as add new conversions as well. Now, if we are in shape data mode, we just read everything and save directly into tables. Then the OpenTRACK folder is created, and the track model name is generated from the known information. After this, the log file is deleted and recreated, and the heads-up display is updated. Now, we pre-process the data before we start meshing the track. Again, we check in which mode we are in. If we are in logged mode, we start saving the unique values of the distance vector and the rows we need to keep from the other variables. Then, we remove the needed rows and filter each variable accordingly. Here we shift the x-axis in case the first point is not zero. And here is where we calculate our curvature depending on the value of the logged mode. Then we filter the curvature again. You can remove this line if you think there is too much filtering going on. Here we mirror the curvature if needed. Then we calculate the track length and save the old position vectors for use in the interpolation later. If we are in shape data mode, we start by converting the tables to arrays. We set all the radius values on the straights to infinity, calculate the track length, and convert the segment type variable to a number. Again, here we mirror the track if needed, and here is where we start injecting extra points for the long corner correction. We start by calculating the segment angle, and then we create a new J index and three new vectors. Now we loop through all the segments, And for every one of them, we check if its angle is larger than the kappa angle. If it is, then we calculate the injection length and make the injection. Then we update the J index. If the angle was less than the cap angle, then we just update the J index and move to the next I index. So I is the index used to go through the old vectors, and J is the index for the new ones that change size. Then we overwrite the old vectors with the new ones. Here is where we go on to create the new final vectors. First, we calculate the position vector that shows the end of each segment and the vector pointing to the center of each segment. Then we create a new J index and pre-allocate in memory the new position and radius vectors. We now loop through all the segments and check if we have a straight. If we do, we just inject the end of the straight to our vectors and update the J index. And if we don't, we just save the center of the corner as our point and update the J index again. After this is done, we get the values for the rest of the topology variables and omit all the points that reference a distance larger than the track length. Then we save the old position vectors and the old topology vectors. Now we move on to the meshing commands. Here we see the new position vector that utilizes the mesh size. We also see the new distance step vector. Here we save the total number of nodes. And after, we start the interpolation of all the variables to actually create the new mesh. Now, to create the map, we pre-allocate in memory the X and Y vectors, get the segment angles and the heading angles, and then we proceed to the tangency correction for the closed track if needed. So if the track is closed, we get the two values for the heading angle error and then choose the minimum absolute value. Then we proceed to stage 1 and do the tangency fix and recalculate the circular segment angles. And here, now that the heading angle vector is known, we just remove the first value. Finally, we go through and generate the first version of the track by looping through all the points, getting the starting point, calculating the next point, and then saving the X and Y components. Here we calculate the apexes just by using the find peaks function of MATLAB on the absolute values of the curvature to get the apex indexes, and then we use those indexes to get the actual values for the curvature. Here we do our final map edit. First, if the direction setting is set to backward, we flip all the vectors accordingly, then we visually rotate the map, and then we proceed to stage 2 of the map closing fix if the track is closed. Here we calculate the position errors, the banking error, and add the corrections to the position and the banking. Then we calculate the final inclination, and here we smooth the inclination. Here is where we plot the results. We first create an arrow for the starting line. Here we create our figure, define our rows and columns, and create our subplots. And here is where we save the model, keeping in mind that we only need to save some specific variables and not everything in memory. Okay, so that's it for today. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave them below, and I will do my best to answer all of them. In the next video, we will talk about the straight line simulation in OpenDRAG. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you next time.